Am I audible to everyone? I'm pressing it still. Hello. Okay. I can speak. Am I audible to you? Maybe some of you can come this side. So, press it. That's fine. I'll speak it out. Thank you. So, if I'm not audible, maybe you may want to come a little closer. So first, thank you for coming today. I'll speak on the topic of tapping our inner power. Broadly, there are two kinds of people in the world. Some people are wise and some are otherwise. And it's not just there are two kinds of people. We ourselves are sometimes wise and sometimes we are otherwise. And what we are is not so much seen in situations where things are going according to our plans. It's when we have power, whether it be physical power, financial power, technological power, and we can make things go according to our will, at that time, all of us can act reasonably. But it's when life puts us in situations that are disempowering. That is the time when our inner metal comes out. And we talk about, through technology, we have been able to tap a phenomenal amount of outer power. But inner power is what will enable us to bring our best into the world. Technology can, to some extent, now by clicking a few buttons, we can get the best information from all over the world. But how do we bring out our best so that we can contribute constructively, we can achieve successfully? Whenever we face outer obstacles, at that time, the sense of powerlessness can dishearten and disorient us. So when we face difficulties, as we all do sooner or later in life, inner power is basically the power to manage our inner world, our thoughts, our emotions. And when we face obstacles, those obstacles can either make us bitter or they can make us better. Sometimes we have to climb a steep mountain. And especially when we feel that this is such an obstacle that I can't deal with. We see mental health problems increasing enormously. And it is, if you look at the physical level, it's not that physically life has necessarily become tougher. In fact, we have more comforts today available even to common people than what were even conceivable for royalty a few centuries ago. Whether it is air travel, whether it is telecommunication. So we are more comfortable, and yet we are more, especially at the mental level, distressed. So we could say we are comfortably distressed. And Martin Luther King put his finger on this over half a century ago when he said that we have guided missiles and misguided men. Our scientific power has outrun our spiritual power. Now, what did he mean by spiritual power? Is that our inner sense of purpose and meaning in our lives. So I'll talk about it. When we face disempowering situations, it's easy to blame. Is it easy to rant at destiny or whatever is out there? But that only makes us bitter and makes things worse. Then what can we do? Any situation that we are in, we are not so much annoyed or frustrated with problems or pain. What annoys and frustrates us is pointless pain. It's purposeless problems. Suppose we are walking on the road and a thorn pricks us in the foot. We'd be annoyed, irritated. But if we go to a doctor and the doctor gives us a dose, the sensation is the same. But the context is different. In the second case, because we know the pain has a purpose, we are not only ready to accept that pain, but we are even ready to pay the person who is causing us that pain. So, problems are not exactly the problem. It is pointless problems. It's purposeless or meaningless problems that irritate us. And that disorient us and that can completely dishearten us. So now, if we want or we can accept problems that are meaningful, that are purposeful, so where do we get meaning from? Actually, the sense of meaning is directly proportional to the sense of responsibility. In any situation, the more responsibility we take, responsibility itself brings meaning. So, for example, if somebody is just mindlessly surfing on the net, now for them, they may be watching movies and they may watch video games and whatever else, and that is just meaningless surfing. Now, somebody who's made the movies, making the movie, making the video game, can bring meaning into the life of the maker. Because for them, they're taking responsibility. I want this to function well. But many times when people are just surfing mindlessly, they're evading responsibility. And thus it becomes meaningless entertainment. So, do I need to keep clicking this? Okay, fine. I'll just keep my finger here. I'll take responsibility for this. You can sit comfortably. Fine. So, even something which is good, if it is devoid of a meaningful context, it becomes worthless. How many of you like humor? Anyone? It will be unlikely to find anyone who says, I don't like humor. What's wrong with you if you don't like humor? But suppose, say tomorrow morning somebody told you, from now onward, you have no financial challenges. We'll provide for you financially. You have no professional obligations. You have no family obligations. From morning to night, you just watch comedy shows for the rest of your life. How many of us would want to do that? Maybe for a half an hour, an hour, a few hours at the most if you are very bored or frustrated. But after that, we want to do something. We want to get our teeth into something, have something meaningful, stimulating, challenging to do. So even humor, pleasure becomes pointless if there is no meaning to it. So the point I'm making over here is, okay, is this working now? Okay. Thank you. So do I need to repeat or? Okay. So I was just speaking this point that we all want meaning in our life. And meaning is proportional to responsibility. So humor itself, which is enjoyable, becomes boring and pointless if it just passes. So the more responsibility we take, the more meaning we can get in any situation. And that sense of meaning and purpose will enable us to face difficulties. So when we are in a situation where we seem powerless, so at that time, that disempowering, distressing, problematic situation, we can deal with if we can assume a sense of responsibility, which brings meaning to that disempowering situation. Now, what can we take responsibility for? Now, taking responsibility, you may say, if I have no power, how can I take responsibility? One of the most frustrating things is that if we are held, we are given responsibility, but given no power. You make sure that this unit works, but nobody in that unit listens to you. And you don't have power over those people. Then how, what do we do at that time? So actually, there is something, in fact, three things which we can always take responsibility for. And that's going to be the main part of this talk. We can open When we are in a disempowering situation, we can open a new tab in our life. Tab is an acronym for three things: thoughts, attitude, and behavior. So no matter how disempowering the situation we are in, even if nothing outside seems to be in our power to change, whether it is professionally, relationally, financially, whatever it is, but these three things are always in our power to change. Now, by thoughts, let's see what I mean. Let's look at the first part here. So we are always full of thoughts, but we are not always thoughtful. Thoughts are always going on in our head, but that doesn't necessarily mean those thoughts are being directed constructively. When we are always full of thoughts, that's like if we are in a basement where books are just randomly piled up and we don't even know what to search and where to search it. But if we are in a library and all the books are organized, we know what to search and where to search it. So that's, we are thoughtful. Now, when we think, when we have a problem, when we have a disempowering situation, we naturally need to think about it. But the way our thoughts work with respect to dealing with problems is something like this graph. When we face a problem, if we don't think about it at all, we will act thoughtlessly and foolishly. So the more we think about a problem, the more our clarity increases. I'm getting a better hang on this. But however, this graph doesn't just keep moving straight up like a ever-extending line. Beyond a particular point, it flattens. And then if you keep thinking about the problem, then actually we lose whatever clarity we have. Just as thinking too little can be a problem, thinking too much can also be a problem. At one level, okay, before I go to that point, let me ask a question. So suppose how many of you think that our thoughts are powerful? And how many of you think that our thoughts are powerless? How many of you think that thoughts are powerful? Okay, thank you. Does anyone think that thoughts are powerless? No one? And the remaining, okay, couple of you, thank you. Three or four of you. Anyone has no thoughts about this? No thoughts about thoughts. Okay. So I would like to use a metaphor here to illustrate this principle. This metaphor is drawn from the yogic traditions of India, especially the Bhagavad-Gita. The Bhagavad-Gita explains that our self is three level. There's body, mind, and consciousness. And this is like a computer system, where there's the hardware, the software, and the user. So the physical level, the body is like the hardware, the mind is the software, and consciousness is the user of the software. So now if you have a phone which gives a lot of notifications, the many notifications, sometimes hundreds of notifications might come up from this app, on that app. Now, not all notifications deserve to be noticed. So a notification popping up is like a thought. Some notifications are important. They indicate some change is going to happen here. Your system is going to reboot. To use it this way. You cannot change the settings so that. Yeah. Okay, maybe you can just keep the phone here. You can deceive it. Okay. So, not all notifications deserve to be noticed. And similarly, there are many thoughts which keep popping up within us. So we could say a thought is like a notification. We all use this sense of the word thought when you say, I just got a thought. So in this sense, a thought itself is just a pop-up on our inner screen, in our mind. And just like many notifications come, and if we don't pay attention to the notifications, they might just go. So it might be, oh, this happened in this part of the world and that happened over there. And it might have no relevance to us. So a thought is simply like a notification. Now, when we pay attention to it, say if a notification comes, pops up, then we click on it. And then it can might occupy our full screen. So thoughts in themselves are like notifications. So some notifications are vital. Many notifications might just be casual. So thoughts in themselves may well be powerless, just like notifications. But if we click on them, if we give attention to our thoughts, then they can consume our attention completely. Suppose somebody is staying awake at night and you ask, what are you thinking about? So, I'm thinking whether the sun should rise tomorrow morning or not. What? Yes, your thinking is not going to affect. So that is just a pointless thought. Many of our thoughts are like that. They are about events over which we have no control. Now that doesn't mean all thoughts are powerless. But there are many thoughts which are simply stray thoughts which come and go. And to a large extent, the power of thoughts depends on how much attention we give. Now, some thoughts do need to be attended to, and some thoughts needn't be attended to. So the background I'm giving this to illustrate this point that when we are thinking too little means some notification comes up, it's important, but without giving it due thought, we just click on it. Click yes or click no, whatever. Maybe we should have clicked yes, but we clicked no. Maybe we should have clicked no and we clicked yes. We installed something unwanted on our computer. So there are some times when we think too little. And there are some times when we think too much. When a situation is out there, sometimes the situation is such that our thoughts are not going to change that situation. And thinking about it simply exhausts us. Sometimes our thoughts go round and round and round and round. It's like our mind becomes like a browser in which 37 tabs are open and some loud noise is coming from one tab and you don't know which tab it is. So we are annoyed and we don't even know why we are annoyed. We are confused. Sometimes some people say, okay, earlier I was confused. Now I'm not so sure. What that means is that now I'm confused whether I'm confused also. So we can just get lost in our head. Sometimes we resolve, I will not worry about this. And then we start worrying. And then we start worrying, why am I worrying? We could just get lost in our head. So overthinking is, once we are thinking too much, the more we think, the more disempowered we become. So taking responsibility for our thoughts means ensuring that we think enough. Not too little, not too much. Now, how do we do that? That once we have ascertained that in a particular situation, I have done whatever thinking I could. I have arrived at whatever understanding I could. And generally, if our thinking about a situation is making us tired, making us disheartened, making us exhausted, then that means we have already crossed the peak. So we need to direct our thoughts elsewhere. So we at a functional level have to think about the problems that we have. But beyond that, if we keep thinking about them, we simply burden ourselves. And when we burden ourselves, see, normally when, say, if we have a fan, and the fan goes round and round and round, then at that time, we cool down, because the fan is cooling us down. But when our thoughts go round and round and round, they heat us up. This don't help us. It's very unhelpful. So what do we do? We don't have a button by which we can say, stop thinking about this. But if we practice disciplining our thoughts, say through meditation. Meditation is not just about sitting in a particular posture or breathing in a particular way. Meditation is basically getting our thoughts out of the changing world around us and focusing them on that which is unchanging. So if we have developed a habit of directing our thoughts toward the unchanging, then when the situation starts consuming us with thoughts which are exhausting, we won't get that exhausted because we can rise above the situation. Our circumstances are meant to be like carpet. The carpet needs to be below us. If the carpet goes above us, then we will be suffocated and blinded. Similarly, when our circumstances seem to overwhelm us, when do circumstances overwhelm us? That is when we can think of nothing except our situation. When we can think of nothing except our problem, then the problem has gone over our head. Its circumstances have come about, and that's when we start getting suffocated. So that's why we need to create a habit of regularly distance, raising ourselves above our situations. And that is what meditation does. Meditation is one way, reading wisdom texts and getting some inputs for our spiritual thoughts, which help for our thoughts, which spiritualize them, which take us beyond the transient. That's very helpful. Now that's with respect to thoughts. Does anyone remember what was the second part of the acronym TAT? Now, what do we mean by attitude? The word attitude to some extent has become hackneyed. Now, whenever anybody tells you, don't see that the glass is half empty, see it as half full. You may feel, I've heard this so many times, I just want to see whether there's enough water in the glass to throw on your face. So here, I remember I'd earlier talked about meaning and purpose, that we can accept pain if it is meaningful, if it is purposeful. And even pleasure becomes boring if it is purposeless. So when we are talking about attitude, what we mean over here is that the attitude that things move purposefully in life. That life determines our problems, we determine their size. The more we obsess over them, the bigger they become. So if we are at the bottom of a skyscraper building, it appears huge. But if we are in an airplane above that skyscraper building, it just appears tiny. So attitude refers to where, how we see the things around us. That means, yes, like earlier I said, if we have raised our thoughts above our situations, then from that vantage point, we see that things in the world move purposefully. Purposefully means there is order in our life to some extent. But from order, chaos comes. All of you are sitting here for this talk. Now, every one of you is confident enough that the person next to you is not going to suddenly turn at you and slap you in the face. Now, it's possible. Everybody is coming here for a purpose. So, order means broadly things go the way we expect them to. Chaos means we do something and we don't know what the result is going to be. So in our life, there are orderly situations and suddenly chaos comes. So a positive attitude means that if from order chaos is coming, from chaos a higher order will come. Now, it's not that it will automatically come. We have to do our part. But the chaos is not pointless. It is purposeful. That's it. We could see the attitude, we could see the problem just as a burden, as a part of a higher plan for our evolution. Now, this is what we see in nature also. Nature often makes things to make them better. If you look at clouds, they may look beautiful up in the sky. But if the clouds don't break, there are no rains. I was in Australia about 6 months ago, and there was a severe drought over there. And there were clouds in the sky, but for weeks and weeks the clouds were there, they were not showering. They were using cloud seeding, but the cloud seeding was also not working. Thank you. So often the clouds may look good, they have to be broken so that rains come. Then after that, the ground is there, the ground needs to be broken by plowing so that grains can come out of it. The grains need to be broken so that food can be made out of it. Sometimes if you go to some big events or some people who are into cooking, now they arrange the plate in such an attractive way. All the items are so colorfully and tastefully arranged, you feel as if eating this is committing violence. But then food has to be broken so that we can get energy from it. So in nature, often things are broken so that they become better. And similarly, all of us have our own conceptions with which we operate right now. When we talk about growth, it's not just physical growth, it's not just financial growth. Ultimately, the most important is important growth is the growth in our conceptions of what life is meant for. And we function at a particular conception, and sometimes when that conception is broken, then it's like we are like a baby bird living inside a shell. And when the baby bird is inside the shell, it's comfortable. But as the bird keeps growing, the shell becomes cramped and then the shell cracks. But the shell cracks and the baby bird comes out. Maybe a finger comes, maybe a feather comes out, a wing comes out, and then the shell snaps back again. At that time, it's extremely painful, but the bird keeps pushing. And gradually, with each push, the shell is cracking. And eventually, when the shell cracks, the bird will come out not just into the light and the sky, but it will also have developed strength enough to fly free into the sky. So for all of us, when life puts us in a disempowering situation, it's like we are inside a shell. That shell is our own conceptions. So certain conceptions need to be broken. And that's what growth is about. In fact, every good conversation is a continuous reincarnation of conceptions. When we are talking with some, I had this idea. But that person is thoughtful, that person is wise, then that particular conception dies and a better conception comes over there. And then we speak something and that person hears, oh, I used to think it's like this, but now I think it's like this. So it's a continuous process of evolution. And in that, we need to be ready to move forward purposefully. So if we have this attitude that, yes, these problems are there and bad things do happen. And everything that happens is not good, but everything that happens can be for good. If the bird doesn't break through the shell, it will die over there. So, but if it breaks through, it can be free. So everything that happens can be for good. And this understanding that the universe ultimately moves purposefully is foundational even to science. A few years ago, I was invited to Cambridge University to speak on science and spirituality. And while going there, we passed by the same tree where Newton is said to have seen the fruit fall. Now, some people say the apple fell in front of him. Some people say it fell on him. Now, whichever way, imagine if instead of Newton, a monkey had been sitting there and the apple had fallen. What do you think the monkey would have done? Just grabbed it. He didn't even go away. Now, what did Newton do? What made this apple fall? Now, it's his brilliance that he came up from such a simple observation with the theory of gravity. But at the same time, his question, what made this apple fall? It conveys an attitude, implicit understanding, a presumption, whichever word we want to use for it. It conveys an attitude that apples don't just fall randomly. There is some order behind it. And science ultimately is a search for understanding the order by which material things work. Spirituality, so science is the study of matter. Spirituality is the study of what matters. That when things change in our life, what is it that really matters? What is it that I need to hold on to? And what is it that I can let go of? When a baby bird is inside the shell, it has to let go of the comfort of being inside the shell. What does it need to hold on to? Its own strength. So when we have this attitude that, okay, when a disorder and chaos are coming in my life, there are certain things I just need to let go of, and certain things I need to hold on to. So when we have this attitude that things are moving purposefully, then what can I hold on to? What do I need to let go of? Then we'll find that we will grow forward. And that brings me to the last part, that is behavior. So we could conceive this as a snowball. I was invited to speak at the University of Calgary, and I'm going up a hill, the university was. So that was a season of snow. So we could see snowballs rolling down that hill. It's interesting that when snowballs start, they're not snowballs. They're actually snow pebbles. And somebody on the top, they could just flip it with their toe and the snow pebble will crack into pieces. But as it comes down, 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 it not only becomes a snowball, but at the bottom of the hill, it is a snow boulder. And it can just knock over a fully grown person. So similarly for us, thoughts are like a snow pebble. As it rolls down, the kind of thoughts we habitually have is like attitude. And then it comes into the world of action, that's behavior. So now there may be some situations when we feel, I just can't do anything about this. I'm totally powerless. Sometimes the people around us are so unreasonable. They just don't listen to anything that we do. Sometimes just the global economy goes down, and then what can we do? We're just powerless. Actually, even when we feel that we are powerless, we are not as powerless as we think. And no situation, no problem, however bad it is, no situation can take away from us the power to make the situation worse. Think about the biggest problem in your life right now. Can you make that problem worse?
He said, who will want to? It's a terrible problem.
Yeah, it's a terrible. Nobody's wanting to make it worse. But we are just challenging our idea that I am powerless. And no matter how bad a situation is, we never lose the power to make it worse. I might get a fracture, and with that fracture, I may be bedridden for 6 weeks. We say, I can't do anything. But I can take a hammer and crack my other knee and get another fracture. And nobody would do that at a physical level. But we often do that with ourselves at the mental level. So, no matter how bad things are, if we can make them worse, then that means we can make them better. Sometimes some people fall sick. And then they become so rude, so disagreeable, so irritable that they are sick and they make their caregiver sick of them. And their sickness is not in their control, but how they behave in their control. So in whatever situation we are in, we always have the power to either make it worse or make it better. And this finding what is in our power and doing that, that is key to tapping our inner power. So we can, just as we can make things worse, we can make them better also. So we can either be resentful or we can be resourceful. To be resentful means, why is this happening? Why is this happening? Often in life, resentment of reality hurts more than reality. Things are what they are. It's when we keep resenting them, that's what makes things worse. Resourceful means, what can I do in this situation? Sometimes our expectations just go for a toss in life. Say, maybe we had decided I want to learn rowing and I want to demonstrate to all my friends how smoothly I row. And then we are in the sea and we are about to start rowing, and suddenly a monster wave comes and hits. And the wave is so forceful that there is no boat under us and there are no oars in our hands. And if we still keep going through the motions of rowing, I'll simply sink at that. So if things have changed that much, then what do I need to do? If I'm resentful, oh, why can't I row? I've planned so much, I've prepared so much. I'll forget it. Now, just swim back to the coast first. So we can be resourceful. And how do we go about being resourceful? Here also, it's important to understand that when we are going through difficulties, it might seem like we're in dungeon, the dark place, and I'm trapped over here. But dark times are not like dungeons. They are like tunnels. We will be in those dark times for some time. We just keep walking, keep moving. Small, simple steps. If we take, we'll find that there will be light at the end of the tunnel. And this is the concluding point I'll make, that when we are going through difficult times, unmanageably difficult times can be broken into manageable units of time. That means, especially when things are going well in our life, we can plan long term. Okay, this is where I want to be in 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. It's good. That's good. We should have a long-term vision for our lives. But when things are going wrong, when things are falling apart, at that time, the variables are so many that if we start thinking about the long term, we'll such simply overwhelm ourselves. So at that time, the idea is think small. Okay. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. So can I just do the best that I can for the next one day, for the next 1 hour? Or put it the other way. In that the situation that I am in, what are the three things which I could do which would make things worse? And can I make sure that for the next 1 hour, I won't do these three things? What are the three things that I could do that will make things better? Can I do those three things? And just start off with that. So when you just start with small, divide the frame of reference into smaller units. Just one day, 1 hour. And within that 1 hour, again, they don't need to plan anything big. Just small, simple steps. SSS. Small, simple steps. We find that we have more strength than we think we have. If we just take small, simple steps, see, the problems of today, we'll find we always have the strength to deal with the problems of today. But when our thoughts are wild, are out of control, then the problems of today become compounded by the problems of yesterday and the problems of tomorrow. And say, if we had a 10 kg or 20 kg or 25 kg bag, 30 kg bag, we might be able to carry it. But suppose somebody piled, we had our own 30 kg bag and somebody piled 5 30 kg bags of theirs and somebody else piled 5 30 kg bags of theirs. So we have 10 30 kg bags. We wouldn't be able to move it also. So that one 30 kg bag is like the problems of today. Let me deal with them. And then we divide our frame of reference, working frame of reference, into manageable units. And just take small, simple steps. Then we will find that not only do we have more power than we thought what we had, but we will find that things are not as bad as they appear to be. I'll conclude with this one last point, that when our mind overwhelms us, one way it overwhelms us is by making us believe that the problems are bigger than what they are, and that we have far less power than what we are. That illusion is what we need to counter. And once we counter it, we will be able to move forward. And once we move forward,
actually each one of us, if we pull our act together, we can do better than what we are doing. And how much better we can do, how much better we can be, discovering that is life's ultimate adventure. Life's occasional adventure could be we go maybe to the Himalayas to climb up a mountain, or we go skiing somewhere, or we go surfing. All this is fine. But what will make our life itself a meaningful adventure is pulling our act, putting our act together and finding out how much good we can do. If we learn to tap our inner power by taking responsibility for our thoughts, actions and behavior, then we can open a new tab in our life. And although life may be the same, we will see it differently. Where there was darkness, we'll see light. Where there was hopelessness, we will see hope. And where there was powerlessness, we will see empowering path ahead. I'll summarize what I spoke today. We can have a couple of questions. I spoke on this topic of tapping our inner power. So technology has provided us a lot of outer power, but still we get into disempowering situations. At that time, to move forward, we need to take responsibility. And responsibility is proportional to the mean. Rather, meaning in our life is proportional to responsibility. We might feel powerless, but whatever I have power over, if I take responsibility for it, I can create meaning in my life. And I talked about three things for which we can always take responsibility. What are those three things? Thoughts, attitude, and behavior. So thoughts, talked about how the graph of thought versus time. If we think too little, it's a problem. But if you think too much, it's also a problem. And usually when we have big problems, we tend to think too much about them. So practices like meditation enable us to raise our thoughts above our situations. So then our circumstances become like carpets. They won't be above us, that they blind and suffocate us, but they'll be below us. And then from thoughts, the next point was attitude. That means when problems come, either we can just say life stinks and my life is so unfortunate, problems keep coming, or we say the world moves purposefully. And if a problem is coming, then from the order the chaos has come, from that a better order will come. So we all have certain conceptions which need to reincarnate and evolve, and they are like the shells within which we are living. And if you can break those conceptions, we can grow to a better life, a freer and more empowered life. And the last point was behavior. That no matter how difficult and disempowering a situation seems to be, we always have the power to make it worse. And that means we are not as powerless as we think. If we can make it worse, we can make it better also. And to make things better in difficult situations, it's best to divide unmanageably difficult times into manageable units of time. Just think of today, just think of 1 hour and do the best that you can. And if you take small, simple steps in this way, we'll find that the dark times are not like dungeons in which we are trapped, but they are like tunnels through which we can walk to a place, a better place of light and growth. Thank you very much. Are there any questions or comments? Yes, please. So if other people are involved in the situation, how can we take responsibility? Yeah, I said that it's not so much taking responsibility for the situation as taking responsibility for our thoughts, our attitude and our behavior in that situation. We can't control anyone else. What we can do is, at the very least, we don't let that person control our thoughts, our emotions, our actions. So just because some person behaves unreasonably, that doesn't necessarily mean we have to become unreasonable. So just because somebody else is behaving irritably, unreasonably,
The best way to annoy people who annoy us is to not get annoyed. So some people, they just seem to delight in making other people's life miserable. I talked about two kinds of people, wise and otherwise. Could have two other kind of people also. There's some people who bring happiness wherever they go. And some people bring happiness whenever they go. So, if some people are just in that category where they're just making things miserable for us, then the best thing we can do is not overvalue them. See, this is, there are some, one of the biggest mistakes that we make in our relationships is that we tend to overvalue the people who devalue us. And we don't value the people who value us. There are some people who will just never be pleased with whatever we do. Now, of course, if we are in a hierarchy and we have to get things done, we have to work with them. But we don't have to waste our sense of self-worth and self-esteem on their approval. Okay, this person, just this is the way the psychology is there. It's not going to work. I'll just do what I can over here. But we don't overvalue them. So over a period of time, we will find that if we keep doing our best, sometimes some people will just have too much control over us and they will make a mess of things. But nothing is permanent. Things change. And if we do our best that we can, eventually a situation will come where we can better manifest our abilities and perform better. Okay. Thank you. Any other? Yes.
You talk about thoughts and how overthinking can be a problem. But sometimes we are in the situations where how much ever we think, we are still not able to understand what is the right or wrong in that situation. And then the perspective of other people is so different and you are like trying to figure out what is wrong in your way of thinking and you just like end up thinking a lot. What to do in those situations?
Okay, so if our way of thinking is different from others, and at that time, we tend to overthink without arriving at any conclusion. Okay. So what do we do? It's basically important when we think about certain things. In general, we go through different modes, or we could say frames of mind. The Bhagavad-Gita talks about this as goodness, passion, and ignorance. Or you could call it as, there are sometimes some people make things happen, some people watch things happen, and some people wonder what happened. They just, and we also go through this phase. Sometimes they're just passive in a daze. This person is saying this, that person is saying that. So if there are serious issues which require deep thought, it's best not to try to think of them when we are either physically exhausted or we are psychologically pressured. I have to do this, I have to do that. Make some time for it. When you are calm, maybe do some meditation, do some deep breathing, read something uplifting, and then put some quality time to think about it. So if certain issues need to be deeply thought about, then give some quality time for that. But do it in a way when you won't be pressured by other things. And then we can come to a better understanding. And if at other times that issue keeps bogging us, okay. Is there anything new thought about it? If it is, just note it down. Don't think about it at that time. And maybe have a one, maybe half an hour, an hour in a week where you sit down and maybe write down what you have written. See, for major issues in life, writing down is very helpful. Because when thoughts are inside our head, they just congest. And also, they're too close for us to objectively observe. So when we get thoughts out, then we can, at distance, use perspective. So write down all the important parameters. And then that gives you like a snapshot of your mind. And then every week, decide some time, think about it. Well, it's like you're making that snapshot of a clearer and clearer resolution. Ultimately, life doesn't come with a guarantee of right decisions. But what we can do is make our decision-making process as right as possible. So if we do our homework, then yes, we arrive at a particular decision, we will follow it up with conviction. And there can be conviction without fanaticism. Because, okay, this is why I'm doing this. And if things change, I'm open to change. But it's not that I'm constantly second guessing it. So we can take in other people's opinions, but don't let that alone do the thinking for us. So give some quality time, arrive at some decision, and then move onwards. That makes sense?
Thank you. I think you rightly said a lot of time our life is in the tunnel, but the other part which I see, we are not alone in the tunnel. And you have family, your surroundings, and then you try to go some way, and your family try to go the other way. So it's a conflict of inner power. They're trying to influence your inner power with their inner power. So how to deal with those situations? Because you cannot go alone because you are in a social world, you are with a family and everything. But everybody wants to go in a different way.
Yes. If in a tunnel, different people want to adopt different solutions. So which way do we go? Or what do we do at that time? In any relationship, so there is a obligatory part and there's a voluntary part. That means just because two people are officially in a relationship, that doesn't necessarily mean their hearts are close to each other. So what happens is every relationship, there is some contribution that we do and there is some expectation that we have. Now, when we feel that the contribution we are doing is far more than whether our expectation is getting fulfilled, that's when the relationship starts becoming strained. And different relationships at different times work best at different distances. So sometimes we may want too much closeness in the relationship. Not too much in the sense that we feel this is the natural closeness in the relationship. But maybe the other person doesn't want that. And then when our expectation from the other person is too much, at least they feel it is too much, then that creates a stretch in that relationship. So the point here is that different relationships, the same relationship, sometimes two people may be very close, sometimes they may drift away. Now, drift away doesn't mean they have broken apart. It's just that drifted away. So we cannot have the same level of closeness in a relationship at all times. And in difficulties, different people react differently to difficulties. Now, some people process things by talking with others. Some people process things by just being alone and thinking. So in every relationship, sometimes we need that connection. Sometimes we need space. So good fences make good neighbors. If this flower is growing in my side of the garden, no, it's growing in my side of the garden. Have a fence. So rather than thinking that everybody is pulling in different directions, just think that everybody needs, maybe this is the time when they need space. And that doesn't, it's just because they are thinking or wanting to do something differently from us, that doesn't necessarily mean the relationship has to break apart. It just means that maybe this is the time when some more distance is needed. Now, distance itself does not mean alienation or breaking down. We all need space. So maybe in the heat of the moment, we might speak something, they might speak something, it might just make things worse. But if both people are calm at some time, then we may need to renegotiate at what distance this relationship is going to work. So if we can understand that this is the space, this is the time when they need space, this is the time when I need space. So then we renegotiate the distance, then both can work together. So that is, often we assume that I am at a particular level of closeness in this relationship. And we expect the other person to be at the same level of closeness, but they may not be. And then give them the space, and then things can still move on. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Yeah, there's a question here. Yeah.
So sometimes in life, like some tragedy happens, and your mind is so much occupied with the tragedy, you don't remember all these things, and I have to take this point. You don't even remember what should I do.
Okay. So, when something tragic happens in our life, we just
forget whatever good we have learned, and then we end up doing bad things. We all are creatures who have a body and a mind. And the mind, many ways, works like the body. So if my hand gets fractured, then normally I might have been able to lift a heavy suitcase. But when my hand is fractured, I can't lift. So the doctor might say, just keep your hand motionless. No weight on it. So that is essential for healing. But after some time, the same doctor will say, no, start moving your hand. Start lifting weights. So in the journey of healing, there is some time when we need to be motionless. And then afterwards, motion is required. So similarly for each one of us, when we get emotionally wounded, life's tragedies can emotionally devastate us. So at that time, we will go through different phases in the healing journey. And when we are wounded, we have to understand that emotional wounds are like physical wounds. I cannot expect the same things from myself as I expected when I was healthy. So yes, I can't lift weights. So if we have to lean on others, see, the heaviest burden that we carry is not on our back, it's on our face. A mask is often the heaviest burden to carry. So if we are emotionally wounded, then we may need support. And there's nothing humiliating about that. It's just like a physical wound. Yeah, I have a fracture, I can't carry this bag. So yes, I'm too troubled right now, I can't deal with this. So when we are in that phase in the healing journey, when we need to take care of ourselves. So just avoid stressful situations, avoid things which are going to torture us or strain us, and try to heal yourself. So what do we do for healing ourselves? First is lower your expectations from yourself in the immediate wake of the tragedy. And then within that, it is, we all need something unchanging in our life. So basically, tragedy means that something which is essentially, it means something which is very important for us that has been taken away from us. So the closer the thing to us, and when it is taken away, the greater is the impact. So we need some unchanging thing to hold on to. And usually, spirituality, meditation, spiritual wisdom texts, these can help us tune our consciousness to something unchanging. So one is social support we need, but along that, spiritual support. And with that spiritual support, we'll find as things like this is a terrible devastation in my life, but still life goes on. The more things change, the more we need to hold on to things that don't change. And that's what the Bhagavad-Gita talks about, an indestructible core within us, a spiritual dimension to reality that is unchanging. So turning toward that is quite helpful. And then gradually, it's like if our fracture recovers, we don't start lifting big weights. So start taking small steps. So after tragedy, don't be too harsh with yourself. To be impulsive, to do things which we should not be doing, that's understandable. Sometimes we might snap at people, sometimes we might say things which we should not have said. But don't be too hard with yourself. Now, don't, in general, in relationships, it's important to not see intention in things that are done intention. When somebody is intention, and they do some things, don't see intention in that. That is not done intentionally. That doesn't make somebody a bad person. So even if under situations we do something which we should not have done, don't be too harsh with yourself. Just find out where you can get that strength and start doing small things. We have far greater resilience than what we think we have. But resilience comes through gradual recovery. So I might not be able to even lift my finger when my hand is fractured. But maybe a couple of months later, I'll be able to lift a huge weight also. But I have to go through that journey. So we have strength. But first, you need social support. We need social support. So don't feel embarrassed or weak about seeking that. Then see according to your spirituality how you can get some higher support. And then just be kind with yourself to gradually take steps forward. And then our resilience will act and we will find that we have strength that we didn't know we had. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Anyone? Yeah. In the last question.
Kind of piggybacking off of that, I felt that in life we are our worst critics, or extremely mean to ourselves. We give mean things to ourselves, we grade ourselves up not good enough, I'm not smart enough, I'm not great enough. And you get stuck in the cycle where you're the one who's hurting yourself the most. How do you get out of that cycle? How do you be kind to yourself and not expect that from outsiders?
Okay, so how can we be kind to ourselves? Yes, I talked about this model of the self as consciousness, mind and matter, mind and body. So the mind is like the software and the software gives certain notifications. So now when a notification pops up, if we understand, just because the notification has come doesn't necessarily mean I have to see it. Doesn't mean I have to notice it. So we need to create the distance between ourselves and our mind. So if I have this mic here and I have this phone here. Now if you ask me, which of these are you? Are you the mic or are you the phone? Well, I'm neither. I'm the observer of both of these. So similarly, there is a part of us which is hypercritical. Now that is not you. Similarly, there could be a part, see basically for within all of us, there is a creative side and a critical side. The creative side comes up with ideas. It is the generator of quantity. And the critical side is the generator of quality. Like I'm an author, so the creative side comes up with ideas. Write about this, write this, write like this, write like that. And that's important. But the critical side is what, hey, this doesn't make sense. And then the critical side is the editor within me. And the critical side ensures quality. Now the problem comes either when the critical side becomes so strong that the creative side doesn't come out at all, or both the critical and the creative side work simultaneously. So the idea is generated and rejected, generated and rejected, generated and rejected. So what we need to do is we separate the two. So one way to do it is to attribute the negative critical thoughts to your mind. I'm worthless. Okay. My mind is saying, I'm worthless. So it's like a notification coming on your inner screen. If somebody else came to you and they said, I'm worthless. Okay. The first thing was, what happened? You wouldn't say yes or no. What happened? And then maybe you can help them process that situation. So whenever these critical thoughts start coming in, you just make this as an exercise. Attribute it to the mind. And one way to attribute it to mind is just to softly articulate it. I'm so dumb. The mind is saying I'm so dumb. Oh, okay, the mind is saying. Now, maybe I acted dumbly, but that doesn't make me a dumb person. I can learn from the situation. So we need to create that distance between ourselves and our mind. And our mind is like a software program. So just because it goes off in a particular direction, it thinks particular kind of thoughts. That doesn't necessarily mean those thoughts are necessarily what we have to accept. Say suppose somebody has visited a particular website. Say maybe they visited sports.com repeatedly. And now they come for a spiritual talk like this, and now they want to know what is spirituality. And they go in their browser and start typing spirituality. S-P. And what happens? Sports.com comes up. Although they didn't want to go there, but that came. Because that's the default stored from the past visits. So similarly, for us, based on the past ways we have thought, our mind will think in particular directions. So again, be patient. In the Bhagavad-Gita, for managing the mind, two things are talked about. Patience and perseverance. Patience means don't expect the mind's thoughts to change immediately. I'm not going to be so critical. Then the mind will be critical. Just attribute it to the mind. And then evaluate it. So if you could just do this, sometimes we'll be able to do it maybe after the event. Instead of just beating ourselves up. Why did I do that? Why did I think like that? Why did I behave like that? Okay. That was the point where my mind caught me. I got misled by it. So we learn about it. So basically distancing, we are not the software. We are the user of the software. Understanding that and creating that inner distance can help us to avoid the hypercriticality of the mind. Okay. So thank you very much for your attention and participation. So if you want to